of you is still using Windows 3.1? Give me a sign. Oh, there's always somebody kidding. I know it. But seriously, who is still using SQL 92? Give me a sign. You see? More. Why is it so? And that's the question. Everybody knows Windows 3.1 is outdated. And as a matter of fact, SQL 92 is also outdated. It has been preceded by newer releases of the SQL standard. And the standard, I think there are quite some interesting things in there which you should know as a developer, even if you're focusing on front end. And this talk will go through some of the, all of the standards that came out after SQL 92 and picks just a few features which I would like to demo. So you get an idea what you might have missed in the past 25 years. So let me start with the first one, the first standard that came after SQL 92. That was SQL 99. And the interesting thing about SQL 99 is that it kind of broke with the relational model. From SQL 99 on, SQL was not limited to the relational idea anymore. This is something you really need to understand. That's an important move in this standard. However, I just take one feature out there because of time constraints, and the feature I'm showing you here is the grouping sets. So what is it about? There was one limitation, and this is a pattern I will repeat in this talk. I will first show you how the problem looks like, why it was a problem with SQL 92, and now a better solution with more modern SQL. So imagine you want to do some reporting, like some figures, revenue figures, on a, let's say, a monthly basis. So one row for each month, like this query does. But at the same time, you would also like to have the same data analyzed another time. You would like to have the super totals for each year. Have you ever had something like this? Okay. So what's the SQL answer to that? Or what's the SQL 92 answer to that? Run two queries. That's one of the answers. The other answer is just combine them into one query. Because SQL, even 92, had already the concept of composability, and you can stick together queries like this. So you can say, I would like to have this result concatenated with the other result. Of course, it's a lot of typing, there's a lot of redundancy, and so on, and so on, and so on. Therefore, we have something better now. And this is what it basically looks like. So in the group by clause, you can nowadays have the grouping sets clause. And there you can basically say, I would like to have one grouping based on year and month, and then another grouping just on month. Just on year, sorry. And if you compare the left and the right-hand side queries, the result is the same. It's exactly the same. It's just a shortcut for this union. And of course, at runtime, it's way faster because it's only executed actually once. It's basically as fast as one group by. So this is something really useful. There are even shortcuts like rollup, like if you want to have the grouping, the example I have here in the last line is ABC, rollup ABC means basically do the grouping by ABC, AB, A, and over the empty set, which means over everything. So that's all there. And that is in the standard since 99, so almost 20 years. Okay? But the question is, well, the standard is just a sheet of paper. Well, it's a PDF download, and it's not one paper. It's about 4,000 pages. But yeah, it's just paper, basically. So can you use that in the databases you are using every day? And for that, I have these slides in there. So you can see that almost all the databases you might use have some support for this. In example of MariaDB and MySQL, it's only yellow because they can only do the rollup and not the fully configurable solution to that. So a small and handy thing to get started. Let's skip over to the next standard release, because that one was the actually big one. SQL 2003, and the focus of SQL 2003 was on data analytics, and I would like to show you the over clause. Who knows the over clause? Okay, who is scared of the over clause? Yeah. It's a little bit interesting. So I've split it up into three sections. The first one is and partition by, over and partition by. And again, I would like to demo, what is the problem? What was hard to solve in SQL 92 without that feature? And as a matter of fact, SQL 92 combined two concepts in a way which didn't make sense afterwards. And the first concept is merging rows that share some common values in some columns. You can either use group by, then you can say in which columns you would like to check for the same values, or you use distinct at the select, like select distinct, and then all the rows that have the same values in all columns are merged, basically. That's the one concept. And that has been tied together with the other concepts, which is aggregating data, using aggregate functions, sum, min, max, and so on. And as you might know, if you want to use an aggregate function, you have to use group by in SQL 92. I'll demo it in another way, in a matrix form. Let's just start with a simple query that just gives you raw data, no aggregation, no merging. And then on this axis, I just start to merge rows. And the simple case is, of course, select distinct. So all the rows that have the same values in both columns will now be collapsed into a single one. So far, so good. And then we have also, on the other axis, we have the group by. So if you're doing group by C1, it means all the rows that have the same value in this column C1 will be merged into one. And on top of that, you are now allowed to use aggregate functions, like I have the sum function in there in this example. And here comes the question, how to fill that gap? What if I want to have the original data and next to it one more column with an aggregated data? And it's no problem in SQL 92. If you want to have the raw data, just query the raw data, then prepare a join, put in this one, and then you can select it. And this is the real power of SQL 92, composability. Every problem can be solved by composability in SQL 92. And I can see it in your faces. You are excited. Me too. I mean, composability is a good concept in its own, no question. But if you need it for simple stuff as well, okay. So we have something more powerful now. And this is how the new query looks like. So there's an aggregate function followed by the over clause. But I go to another example to demo it step by step. Look at this query. It's just unaggregated, just some query and the result on the other hand of the side. And then look here. There's a comma, which means I'm adding a new column to the result. And if I want to use an aggregate function, well, just go ahead, use the aggregate function. But if you don't want to add a group by clause, you have to add an over clause instead, right after the aggregate function. And if you have the empty over clause, like I have it here, parenthesis open closed, it means over everything. And the result you will get from this query is basically the same everywhere, but you have now applied the aggregate function without doing a grouping. And that's the key idea. If you don't want to use group by, you have to have some other means to specify over which rows you would like to do the aggregation. And this is exactly what the over clause does. But you can do more with it than just empty brackets. You can say partition by, which is very similar to group by. I still don't know why they didn't say group by in there. Here it is, partition by. But it segregates this result very much like group by does. So the rows with the same values in those columns will be put into a partition, and then the aggregate will be done partition by partition. So you're getting basically the total salary for each department in this example. But that was only the first step of this over clause. Let's look at over and order by, because in the over clause you can also use order by. And that might come like a surprise, because the last time I checked, like 1 plus 2, 2 plus 1, the result was kind of the same, at least close enough. So what is it about? And it turns out it's not about affecting the result of the aggregation. It's another way to specify over which rows you would like to aggregate. I'll show you. The example I show you is a typical banking example. Like, I have transactions. And what I would actually like to have is, at each transaction, I would like to know the balance up till there, running total. So at the first transaction, if there's a deposit of 10, there is 10, and so on. The second one, plus 20, is 30, and so on. How can you do that with SQL 92? You know it already. It's composability. So we can use a subquery. Isn't that great? Just put a subquery in there where we aggregate all the transactions that happened to be before the current transaction. And that's not really a bad solution, except that it's, well, it's SQL 92. But here you look, here is the distinction made, which transaction should be included, so all those that happened before, including to the current one. And if we would like to translate this into an overclause, we have a problem, because the partition by, which I've shown you before, that uses an equals operation to put rows into that partitions. And this is why we have the order by clause. We can find another means of explaining how to specify over which rows we would like to do the aggregation. So we start with, again, sum over, and then we put in an order by for the sole purpose to tell the database, hey database, I'm gonna tell you a story about something that happened before and something that happened after. And whenever I refer to something like before and after, this is the order I mean. Okay? And once I have ordered it, I can say, only aggregate the rows between unbounded preceding, all the rows upstream, and current row, for example. And when the database calculates the first result, unbounded preceding and current row are both the same. But when it goes over to the second one, unbounded preceding is still the top, but current row is the next one. And this is what we call a frame, a data frame, which we would like to do the aggregation upon. So this is how you do the running total nowadays. But here, oh damn, now I made something wrong. I forgot that there are also accounts there. So what I did now, I actually combined your deposit with your withdrawal. Not a good idea, but no problem, because you can still use partition by additionally, and partition by will isolate those partitions perfectly from each other, so you don't have to worry. Once you have put in partition by account, they are segregated. So this is the key idea of the order by in the overclause. But once you have the syntax of order by in over, you can also make other use of it. Like there are new functions, like row number, rank, dense rank, to name a few important ones. The difference between rank and dense rank is basically, if you have X equal placements, like first, second, second, who is next? Is it the third or is it the fourth? SQL has functions for both of these. So what are the use cases for this functionality? Whenever you want to do an aggregation without group by, the overclause must pop up in your brain, because this is what we have it for. Running totals I've shown you. Moving averages. Look at this beauty. Here. Between three preceding and three following. So up to seven rows will be aggregated here. Ranking. Top n per group ranking. Like I'm basically, what I'm doing here is I'm counting the row numbers, so numbering them, but in a partitioned way. So in each partition, it starts with 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, and 1, 2, 3, all over again for each partition. And then I'm chopping off everything which is more than 3. Top n per group. Avoiding self-joins. Who is doing self-joins? Oh my God. All employees must wash hands after using self-joins. Self-join is really, it was a required and nice thing in SQL 92, but it's outdated. When you use a self-join nowadays, you're using 25 years old SQL, not today's SQL. So if you see a self-join, kill it. There are many, many more use cases. I've mentioned that basically. So can you use this technology yet? I bet you can. I'm pretty sure you have one of these databases that does support it. Out of these seven, even SQLite started like 2 weeks ago to have that. So who's developing on Android? So just wait another 10 years, then it's there. But really, window functions, this is the name, another name for the overclause, window functions, is one of the most important innovations we have there since decades. And it's so important that even other tools, like what I found here is Heap, Impala, Spark, NeuroDB. There's also BigQuery, and there are many other tools that offer this concept. If you're not using this, I'm sorry, then you're doing it wrong. Skipping to another feature, the filter clause. I like it very much. It's so tiny, but it's really what I like it. I show you again first how to do it without that feature. And the problem I'm going to show you is the pivot problem. Like you have a long result and you would like to turn it into a wider result. The example I'm using here is sales data, of course. And I would like to get a report where I have one row for each year. Therefore, I'm starting off with group by year. So I'm getting one row for each year and then one column for each month. How to do that? It's actually quite simple. Here it is. So you're basically using an aggregate function, sum in that case, of course. And what you're then doing, you're using a case statement inside there, where you just pick the ones. Those where month equals one, you take the revenue. For the other ones, you just ignore it. And you're selectively accumulating the totals here. And there are even some shortcuts possible, because if you don't have an else clause in case, then else null is the default. Sum in the turn will also ignore null values. So if you have else null, it will just be ignored. That's basically what you want. So you can write it a little bit shorter as well. But that's as good as it gets in SQL 92. And case actually was part of SQL 92 and is widely supported. So that works pretty much everywhere. Still, I find that one more beautiful. You can now have, after an aggregate function, a filter clause where you have an additional where clause where you just say which rows should be aggregated. It's the same concept, basically, just more beautiful syntax. And to put that in a picture, because pivot is one of these common problems that is done with left join. Who is doing left joins for pivot? Oh my God. It's also a self join, you know? So instead, follow these rules. Just use group by to define which rows you would like to have, like I did it here. If you want to have one row for each year, then I'm saying group by year. And then use that filter technique, or if you want to, you can also use the case technique to handpick the values you would like to accumulate. I'll show you another example, the entity attribute value model. Who's knowing that? Entity attribute value, where you have basically three columns, like I have it here, and you have dynamic attributes, like in shop system, it's quite popular where you don't know which products have which properties in advance, and you want to have it configured dynamically. But sometimes you need to turn it into a long table. How to do that? It's the same problem. It's pivot, basically. So if you want to get one row for each entity, just start with group by entity, and then just pick the values you like it. And I've taken here the max function for the sole purpose because max works on strings too. So if these are string data, then you can max it. And you basically say which one you would like to have in which column. You can do fancy stuff there because you can also use other aggregate functions like ArrayAgg, XMLAgg, JSON ArrayAgg, or GroupConcatenate, or whatever. You can use all of them there. Okay, you can do really, you can list processing in there. And you have to pick the attributes, of course. But you can use that in the having clause as well. Like, I would like to have only those entities where there is exactly one email address configured. So just count how many email addresses are there. Or you can say, if there are configurations with more than one website, I would not like to have that. Okay, it's really powerful but simple. And all of that can be done with SQL 92 as well, if you use the case technique instead of the filter clause. Because that's the bad thing about it, the filter clause is barely supported now. I find it highly useful and more easy to understand. Unfortunately, the vendors don't agree. But SQLite got something recently. Okay, so this was just some selected features out of SQL 2003. I'm now skipping over to 2008. I've actually left out one, 2006. Because I don't like that so much. Who is using XML? Yeah, that's what I thought. So 2006 basically introduced XML to SQL. So let's go on to 2008. What was introduced there? The so-called fetch first clause. You know that for sure, because now this is the standard answer to limit, basically. Who knows limit? Yeah. So it's the same functionality, but limit isn't standard. So what was the standard way to basically do that? To fetch the first, let's say, 10 rows only. So if you have the row number function already, you can number the rows and then in an outer query chop off what you don't need. So that's standard conformant, but to be honest, it's not really nice. So the typical answer is, oh, damn it, and standards, what the let's just take the proprietary version. Why not? It's not bad, that's limit. It's just it doesn't work in any database. In Oracle, it doesn't work. Okay. So now we have a standard version there, and it's called fetch first 10 rows only. Yeah, quite some keywords. They made it quite funny, because you can even say fetch first one row only. Important. You don't have to. It's just accepting both versions. So I could also say fetch first 10 row only. I'm just a messenger. So let's see who is supporting this feature by now. And here I might need to explain it a little bit, because green means it understands fetch first and so on. Yellow means it understands something which is equally easy to use, like limit in MySQL. Yeah, basically limit is left. In MariaDB, MySQL, and SQLite, you still have to use limit because fetch first is not supported there. Nevertheless, fetch first has some interesting features, like you can also fetch first 10% only. And you can include ties if there are multiple rows having the same order by value. So it's really powerful. It's more powerful than limit. Nevertheless, let's go on. SQL 2011. They introduced an interesting feature. Who knows offset? Yeah, that's kind of strange. In 2008, they introduced a standard version of limit, and 3 years later, they introduced a standard version of offset. What's wrong there? Who's using offset? Oh my god. Again, who's using offset? Okay. All employees must chop off hands after using offset. Really, offset is evil. It's really evil. Of course, you could use it. This is the syntax, so offset 10 rows, there you say, again, rows. But this is my answer. Don't use offset. I don't have the time to go into details, but I have coasters up there. So whoever is using offset should definitely take one, because there is a URL written there. And on this URL, I'm explaining what's bad about offset. And the teaser is it's just two things. The first one is it may be slow. And the second one is it may be wrong. So slow and wrong, what else do you need? Of course, there is also another approach to solve this pagination type of query explained on this website. So grab the coasters. They are two-sided. On one side, the cute scribble. On the other side, the no offset banner. And there are also no offset stickers. And the URL is also written there. Just grab them right after the talk. So can you use offset? Of course, you shouldn't. Let's go to over again, because over is a really great feature. Over was extended once more. And to show you how it makes life easier or more understandable, the queries, how does it make the queries more understandable, I'm coming up with another example, which is the opposite of what I've done before with the transactions. With the transactions, I've had the transactions, and I wanted the running total. Now I do have the balances, and I would like to know the difference to the previous state, to the previous balance. So I basically would like to have one more column there where I see what's the difference to the previous balance. And how to do that in, let's say, in not this latest release, but with other means. And there is one funny approach, which is not actually bad. I mean, you can use this order by and in over. You remember when I said unbounded preceding and current row. You can use other stuff in there. For example, here I'm saying between one preceding and one preceding. Does this sound like a typo? Yeah, maybe, but it's not. I can say before one preceding and one preceding, which hits me exactly one row, which will be aggregated, the preceding one. And this, then I can ask for the maximum, for example. Any aggregate function is syntactically valid there. So I ask for whatever, max. And this is then basically the value of the previous row. So this is another teaser, how you can use this order by and between syntax to narrow the number of rows you are accessing via aggregate functions. And this is then basically how you make the difference. You just take the current balance minus the balance from the previous row, and that's basically preceding. But that's still not so easy to understand, so we have a more simple solution now, and this is basically lag. I would just like to access the previous row, and now we have a function for that. It's called lag. And for lag, you could also say not only lag one row, you can give it a parameter like lag three rows behind. No problem. You can even say lead. You can look into the future. I mean, that's awesome. And it's something you can understand if you look at it. Besides that, we have also first value, last value, nth value. We can ignore nulls or respect nulls and so on. So there's really powerful tool which is then easy to understand and solve interesting problems. So can you use lead and lag nowadays in your database? Yes, probably you can, because all those seven databases I'm testing already support it. Okay, coming to another interesting feature, system versioning. You know the problem for sure. Everybody has had that problem in the room. Like for example, master data, always the same example, like you have been a web shop system. You have client data in your database. Clients change names. They marry or whatever. You need to keep track of that. You want to know what was the name at a specific time in point in time. And this is what system versioning is helping you to deal with. So the problem it solves is that insert, update, delete, so writing to the database is destructive. You're losing the old state. That's sometimes a problem. So how is it solved in SQL 2011? So at a table level, you can declare that you would like to keep old versions. And the way you do it is you have to provide two columns where you instruct the database, dear database, take care of these columns. These columns will be the validity time frame of each row. So the way you're doing it, you say, generate this value in this column always as row start, and you have to provide a second one, row end. And then the database will automatically propagate that with the timestamp whenever you do modifications there. But as you can choose arbitrary names and so on, you also have to define a so-called period, which combines those two together into a logical unit. And then you have to enable the with system versioning. And bam, what's happening? If you're inserting something into this table, you don't need to mention those new columns. They are propagated automatically by the database system because it is system versioning. It's transparent. So it sets the start timestamp, but it leaves it open-ended because now it's valid once you inserted it. And if you update it, you end up with two physical rows in there. And the timestamps are set so that it's clear and correct which row was valid at which time, automatically. You don't change your code. And of course, if you delete, it will basically just set the end timestamp. And it's really transparent. If you query for it, you will just get nothing after it was deleted, because it's transparent. That's the idea of system versioning. So the question is, how can I ever access this data again? And there you have a new syntax. So you can use an explicit syntax in the from clause where you say, hey database, I would like to see that table as of this timestamp. And then you will see whatever was true at this point in time. And you can also say, I would like to see everything that happened between this point in time and that point in time and so on. So that's automatically, everything is transparent to your application, but if you want to access old data, there's a specific syntax for that. So who has had that problem before? Yeah. So now there's a standard solution for that. we are coming to the more recent SQL standards now, so please understand that not all databases are supporting that yet. But we have MariaDB here as an open source database that just started supporting what you have seen here on the slide. It works, it's tested, also I tested it a little bit. Quite okay, actually. So in MariaDB, you can already use that starting with 10.3, which was released a few months back. And in the commercial databases, you can also use that. In SQL 2011, so this temporal databases was the big thing in 2011. There's also another versioning, the application versioning, where the application can provide the validity timestamps explicitly. But this is a little bit more complex, so I don't show it here in the slides. So that's the current standard. We have finally catched up. And SQL 2016 was released, yeah, you see the date, so it's not even 2 years old. And it has some exciting features, and I'm just gonna show you one. And that's one small part of the JSON support that was finally added to SQL, to the SQL standard. And if you're using some databases like Postgres, MySQL, or SQL Server, or whatever, you might have noticed that you were able to do JSON before that was released. So obviously, this is not working like the standard. If the standard was released after the databases added the support, it's obvious that they don't do it in a standard way. But they are now adding it in the standard way. And they are really powerful tools. And the one I'm going to show you here is JSON table. How does it work, and what problem does it actually solve? So imagine we have a table called TBL. And there's a column, JSON, or JS column. And I have one document in there, which is basically an array. And in the array, I have two objects. And what I can now do with this function is I can transform it into a regular table, where you can then work on with SQL. And the way it works, in the from clause, you just say JSON table. Then you have to specify where the JSON document is stored, of course. And then there comes something which is called a JSON path expression. And this expression, the example I'm having here, so the dollar sign is basically the anchor to the root node. And the, in brackets, the star means all elements of this array. And each element, each item that expression matches will be turned into one row of the result. And then you can go on and specify the columns you would like to have. Like, I would like to have one column called ID of type integer, and the value shall be taken according to this JSON path expression, which is now in the dot notation, which is a member of this object, of this JSON object. And you can additionally even say, like, if you have multiple rows you are hitting, then number them so that I can easily refer to them in the result table. And what does the result look like? It's just a table, the values are there, they will confirm to the types you have specified in the columns clause, and the n column is basically the for ordinality, so you have something which is numbered in case you have multiple things. And this is really just one piece out of the JSON functionality provided by SQL 2016. It's not widely supported yet, I must admit, but you see it's moving. I mean, that was released like 2 years ago. Oracle had it before, so they are pretty good at pushing stuff into the standard which they invented. MySQL is now Oracle-owned, so they also have it for whatever reason. Might be a coincidence, who knows. But I know that other databases are working on that one as well. So I think it pays off to have an eye on that. Because now coming to the end of this talk is, what is it about modern SQL? Of course, I could go on forever and show you feature after feature after feature. But OK, that's too much. What is it about? You need to realize that SQL has really evolved beyond the relational model. Do you remember when the NoSQL folks said, oh, we should have actually called it NoRel for no relational? Do you remember that? Yeah? Yes? No? Yeah? So NoSQL, at one point in time, they said it was a badly chosen name because it's not about SQL, it should be no relational. But guess what? When I started with the first presentation, you remember when I said in SQL 99, the International ISO Committee already agreed on extending SQL beyond the relational model. SQL is not just relational. Many, many of those new things have nothing to do with the relational idea. So whenever somebody comes and tells you, okay, a relational database might be the wrong choice here, then say, no problem, I'm using SQL anyway. This is beyond relational. Well, and I'm sorry. You're most probably doing it wrong. At least if you're using offset. And really, a lot has changed. The SQL standard, it has some 4,000 pages, and it's, of course, hard to read, but there are some genius concepts in there. I've really just shown you a few in there. So to put it up like this here, you know what that is? The tip of the iceberg. That's pretty much what I've shown you just in the last 40 minutes. Just a few selected features. And there are really hundreds more to discover. And they can change your life. They can make it easier. They might be available at your database already, so you might be able to use them with zero effort, except that you have to learn them. So it's upon you. Okay? But here is the only hint I can give you. So I'm running a website called modernsql.com. What a coincidence. You can follow it there on Twitter and whatever. It's entirely free, subscribe, newsletters, and so to stay updated. You will find the slides there. You will find video recordings there. So please, if you think that makes sense, just subscribe, follow it to stay updated, and don't make your choices, or your technology choices, based on myths like SQL is relational. So thank you. Don't forget to grab stickers, and I think we have 5 minutes for questions. So there's one in the front row.
First of all, that was an amazing talk. Thank you. I don't consider myself to be a database expert, but I think I know a thing or two, and damn. The one specific question I have is, I don't think I heard a usable alternative to offset. Like, if you want to page through a flat list of data, that is, you know, coming from web performance.
Yes.
Web performance background is you need to page everything.
Let me give you a teaser on the offset thingy. So because it's always the first question, I should. So why is it bad? It's slow and wrong. The slow is the bigger the number is, the slower it becomes. You might have noticed that already. But why is it wrong? The problem is when you are fetching the first, let's say, 10 rows, and while your user is looking at those 10 rows, there might be an insert. And if you then say offset 10, you are counting again, which means you will get one row again. Have you ever seen the effect that, like, you are looking through a result, and you see, okay, the last result, no, that's not what I wanted, next page, and you get the last result again at the first first. Have you seen that? They are using offset. It's conceptually wrong to implement the idea of give me what's following after what I've already seen. And if you want to see what's following after what you have already seen, the real solution is called keyset pagination. And you have already an order by clause there. That's granted. And what you basically need to do, you need to remember the values of the order by clause and tell, I have seen it up till here, and then write it into the where clause. And now tell me everything that comes beyond. So that's the general idea. But there are some odd ends in there. That's why there is a website, web page for that. OK? Next question.
Hi, great talk. About the JSON part of the talk, how safe is it to use with the sort? For example, because JSON is in one column, and I don't know what the backend is of when it's translating to the columns you can see. So can I just use sort of a property that's in JSON column? And is it slow? Sort is just an example, but other aggregations and queries like that.
Let me bring up that example again. So once you have used the JSON table result, like here, so up till to this closing parenthesis, which is the closing parenthesis here for JSON table, This is just the name of the table, which is it's an alias for the table. So up till here, you will get that result. That means below here, you can still add where clause, order by clause, whatever, and you can refer to these columns in there. It does it. So it means it takes the JSON, it converts it, it sorts it. That's the performance you can expect. You can put actually indexes on JSON items, basically. That works in pretty much every database. So you can optimize it as well. Welcome.
More questions?
I'll ask the one I asked you earlier, which is, which database should I use?
So can you please cut off the video recording? Well, all the databases have their strong points, to be honest. So there are cases where I would say use rather this one than that one, while in another case I might give the different advice. But the default is Postgres.